The new episode, episode one, starts 30-some-odd years before episode four, which was the original Star Wars. Ever since the success of Star Wars, I decided I would go back and tell the backstory of how everybody got there.
Because the tricky part of his...
The films are serials. They are designed, ultimately, to be seen as one big 12-hour film. And in that, there are sections and chapters that actually express the story of a family.
The part for me that was the most revealing was when I first saw some film, especially film of the desert in Tunisia. I said, oh, I'm back. The characters were standing there, and it was Star Wars. I mean, it just we were back there, and it was exactly the same, and it was just like those 20 years had never elapsed. It was pretty amazing.
The difference with this Star Wars is, it's part of a body of work that's been, it was conceived many years ago, and three films were made, 17, 18, almost 20 years ago. It's kind of become mythic already, that we're stepping into shoes in order to be another piece of this jigsaw puzzle that is Star Wars.
Because of what Star Wars movies meant to me when I was a kid, I was about 5 or 6 when the first one came out, so they're more than just movies to me.
The story starts out on the planet of Naboo, which has been blockaded by the Trade Federation. There's speculation in the Queen's Palace of what this means. One of the senators speculates that it means that they're going to invade.
Communications disruption can mean only one thing. Invasion.
I will not condone a course of action that will lead us to war.
In episode one of Star Wars, I play Queen Amidala. She's very powerful and she is in control of everyone, yet she's a very good leader.
Our people are dying, Senator. We must do something quickly to stop the Federation.
She doesn't act for her own good and for her own quest for power. She really tries to do the best for her people. So I think it's a role model really for everyone, and it would be good for young girls to see. I have many beautiful, beautiful costumes. There's so many changes for me because a queen can't wear the same outfit twice.
They're familiar with it because it starts with the same world. It's the same world is what it is, with new characters, or younger characters. But it's great. It's the same kind of fairy tale characters, that make it work so well.
Whoops!
There's never been a real comic character in any of the Star Wars movies, like just outright comic. The character of Jar Jar, he was banished from his world because he was clumsy. He just didn't fit in with the other Gungans of his world. And I think everybody remembers when they were that kid who just didn't fit in. And I know I was that weird kid who didn't fit into any group. I think all those kids and all those, people who feel like they don't fit in will identify with Jar Jar. He wants to fit in and he wants to be with everybody else and he wants to be good. But he just can't help it. He's just clumsy. You relate to the world, even though these are different creatures and different people. Something about it makes you relate to it. Something about it makes you feel for the characters.
The central issue in the film is that a boy is taken from his mother, and that sort of drives everything.
Well, I'm playing the mother of Anakin, and we have a good relationship, my boy and I. And it's a beautiful part. I love it very much. It's so warm, and I feel very familiar about it because I got 3 kids myself.
Anakin Skywalker is a lot like me. He's really mechanical. He loves to tinker with stuff. He's been a slave in his entire life on Tatooine, and now he has to leave his mom. She's been the only person that's there for him for his entire life. He's never had a father, so I think he was kind of confused on whether to go or to stay.
She's very brave in a way to let him go. She really do believe in him.
Mom, I just can't do it.
That he's gonna take the responsibility of his own life.
Will I ever see you again?
George is an expert, and he is one of the world's great storytellers. We were very aware this is, we're part of telling this extraordinary story, and that's, you get a sense of him. It's a very understated expertise he has. Precision and patience, you know?
We're gonna tighten up on Yoda, right. And then we'll tighten up on Sam.
Okay.
You kind of dream about things when you're a young actor and you see things happening, and you wish you could be a part of it. And sometimes, you know, things that you want can happen. And this is one of those kind of dream come true kind of things. I remember actually going to the very first screening of Star Wars in New York City. And I was at the first showing. I was there, I saw it a lot of times after that. I'm a huge fan of the series. The first day was pretty, you know, awesome for me to walk onto a set, looking around at all the people there and the costumes, you know, and then to make it even better, all of a sudden I was there with, you know, Yoda, and the enormity of the situation was everything I thought a Star Wars experience could be. And it never stops. You know, you would think you would get used to it, but I never got used to it.
These movies are so entertaining, and people love them, and little kids love them, and adults love them, and it really spans generations.
George's tales, the Star Wars tales, have really tapped into a psyche and a world that modern popular culture has never done before. And to me, that says, yes, these films are incredibly well made, but also it's tapping into a void that we have as human beings, that we have kind of lost something. And George provides, you know, these films are providing that great storytelling sense of myth.